So welcome to the Etchin' and Half Bar. Some things I kind of want to talk about were what exactly are we going to update, when are we going to update it, and who is going to be doing each part of the work. What are the things other people wanted to talk about? And do most of you know what Etchin' and Half is all about? For the record, it's just the idea is to add a new upstream kernel, possibly new X drivers, maybe, I've heard anything else come up, but the addition of new features, new hardware support, and an update to Etch.
New features or just new hardware support?
New hardware support. I don't necessarily know about.
But new features only if you are very, very, very expensive and don't like anything. So basically it's a no.
Yeah.
Of course, if you say you have a new module, you can load it only if it's loaded and a new feature available. If not loaded, it doesn't. Then I would say yes, you could do it. But I expect most cases it's just a no.
Okay.
At least that's my personal opinion at the moment.
I think that's a good place to be.
Although you will get screwed over with new versions of drivers if they don't work. 20% of users stop.
Basically, one of the things is that we don't want to drop any existing drivers at all. Okay. So we are also not going to drop the existing kernel, we're just adding a new kernel. We are not making automatic upgrades for people. So that if somebody upgrades the new kernel, is screwed, we can still say, well, please go back to the kernel you used to have and it used to work for you. And which is, of course, not what I really want to do, but it's still better than totally screwing them.
What about the installer?
I don't think there's a final decision yet. Part of the talk is to be what should we do with the installer. But current ideas are that somehow we either do a new disk do a new disk with the old installer, or say, well, if you need the new stuff for the installer already, because your hardware is so broken with all things, you need to use the Lenny installer and install an Edge, or whatever. I think that's not yet decided. I even think we can't decide at this moment, because we need to know more what's in the new kernel, how deployed such hardware is that can't even use the old installer for installing only.
Yeah, I think that's my critical desire today, is to make sure that we have a stable install disk that I can install on Intel hardware that's been built in the last year. Because the current stable kernel can't boot on that. We're not booting an install on
it. Why doesn't it boot?
AHCI.
Sorry?
SATA drivers.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. And the E1000, lack of E1000 and AHCI drivers.
And we talked about the current version of the screen.
The current stable install
disk
cannot boot.
But they had E1000.
They might have E1000, but they don't have updated AHCI drivers. AHCI moves from per device IDs to class ID, class base, which means I can take the new AHCI drivers and run them on hardware which we aren't shipping yet. Which is
this happened in 2.6.21.
I think so, yeah. I'm not exactly sure what kernel has the new AHCI model.
The thing why it's broken isn't a change we could easily backport.
I think it can be easily backported.
Okay, so that's something I'd like to do earlier. Because the times we talked about for doing Etchin' and Half have been between 9 and 12 months after the release of Etch. So that'd be starting this fall or most likely this winter. But if there's things that are safe to backport into 2.6.18, I'd rather do that sooner than later.
Okay.
Things that you can show that don't break other hardware.
Okay. One of the things that we definitely will add in 2.6.18 are things like new PCI IDs, for example.
Certainly.
Right.
Just to get you, so that you can get an impression of what we want to do now and what would be only for the Edge plus 1.5.
Have you read the latest Linux Weekly News article? Yeah. Basically, the other vendors are having the same problems. There's a talk between kernel developers, Greg Hartman, and basically Red Hat is shipping, although Enterprise Linux and updates the kernel with heavy backports. So basically, they're shipping now with 2.6.9, and they're constantly backporting stuff, and this is becoming unmanageable. So they're now discussing that maybe the way to go is to ship the latest upstream kernel as is. So it may be worth considering to see what other distributions do with that. Mm-hmm. We're not the only ones that have a problem. Yeah, we have a much shorter cycle than rest other in the type Linux, but it still is a problem with recent hardware, as you said.
I think that's the big transition it's made over the last year, is that Intel has gone from beta to SATA, and that makes it impossible to install. That's kind of a showstopper for a stable distribution when we don't ship unstable install either.
So I think looking at other distributions and seeing what they're planning to do, Max on the kernel team also wants to look and see what kernel other distributions are going to do. I think that's going to be a good guiding point. But specifically, is there hardware besides Intel stuff you already know about? Is there other hardware that's becoming popular, about to be released, that you guys know about that should be supported?
NVIDIA drivers seem to be one of the ones that change depending on what kernel you're using.
But does it mean the NVIDIA drivers we can't install on that hardware? Or does it just mean we are not really using the hardware?
You can install on it, you just don't have any network in.
Which
is pretty bad.
which is bad, but it's not as bad because you can still say, for example, take the new kernel as USB stick,
yeah.
Install it, and you're there or whatever. It's not something I like, but it's not as bad as I would say with Intel ones.
Yeah.
It's just a bit less bad.
But with 100 machines, it really sucks.
I agree.
It's not enough to actually switch to another distribution.
That's what I fear. Yeah.
So the NVIDIA drivers, do you know what the details are? If it's new PCI IDs or actual drivers?
There are newer motherboards that we've had to onboard for hosting company. We've got lots of new servers every week or two. If you're not running the most recent kernels, the drivers just don't work. That's all.
So maybe we should come up with a more general process, like some way of tracking new hardware that a lot of people are using that doesn't work and trying to figure out an approach. Because finally, a bug report against 2.6.18 may not be the best approach, and you might be able to use. So maybe a wiki page or something, but would that work for people to track different hardware? Or do we just want to go by it, let's go to a new upstream and figure out what we're doing otherwise?
Depends. I mean, if you're adding minimal drop support for things, then going to the new upstream might not be the best approach.
Well, like he was saying, we're never going to drop the 2.6.18 in Edge. That'll always be there and be the default. So a new upstream would just be glued on the side.
I guess the question is, would it be on the install media then?
That's to be determined. What Franz was talking about possibly doing was the putting it on a Lenny install media. Install media to install Edge. And I don't know if that was how easy it would be to keep the kernels in sync. Like, we run the risk of having a newer upstream
kernel
in Lenny.
Right. I mean, you find a way to keep it in sync and such. And if you have a big change, like merging the IE stuff.
So Francis isn't here to explain more about what his reasoning for the Lenny installer was, but do you think if the issue is that he wants to not maintain two branches or whoever to maintain two branches, is it still reasonable maybe to build a copy of the Lenny branch to the installer with the Edge kernel? Is that a lot of work?
They're really tricky. We do try to support old versions of the kernel, for as long as we can. It's really hard to say what we're going to have to do to that. And as far as actually building it, I think it's better to get that set up and not having too many changes and how we split the modules and the devs and that kind of thing. So the build process still works with the old ones, basically.
So it sounded like it's to be determined.
Are you thinking any further? Another thing you need to consider is that newer kernels many times require newer user space tools, like Ubuntu or. We had a problem with Start that we didn't have the internal FS, but now I think they're not switching away from internal FS soon. But Ubuntu may need an update or other things.
Yeah,
long as it's not going to be a problem in the foreseeable future for this time around, we don't need to work on it. That's a problem. Although we need to look on a case-by-case basis, I think, because every time it can be totally different interpretability somewhere.
And of course, if you just notice that there's one specific change in the kernel that's not SolidWire, which regards the unit version, you can perhaps even just remove that change.
Yeah, but it's really case-by-case basis.
If we are near a time where we say, now we need to select a kernel. We can't say today what we will do. It's the fault of spacing for the kernel, but not the fault of stepping quality.
Okay, so I guess all we can really do is figure out what exactly we can't do, maybe. What do we know we can't do today? And so, like, for example, would we want to do this without bserver and sin support? Do we consider that a must, that we have bserver and sin in the kernel?
So can you just please?
Bserver.
I could just ask you if you could speak a bit slower and louder today, because
yeah.
I'm really not too well still, so normally have issues understand American people who speak slower. To speak with a very low voice, like Troy, for example.
So yeah, my question was trying to figure out things that we wouldn't do. Is one of those things a kernel without bserver? Too many negatives in there. What do we do an edge and a half with a kernel that doesn't have bserver or zen? Do we consider that a must?
I don't think that bserver is a must as long as it don't support erase all kernels. Because you don't stop support, you can just say, well, if you have newer hardware, you can't use vServer. But the alternative could be to say, well, if you have new hardware, you can't have any kernel.
I would not like to drop the virtualization techniques, especially a newer hardware which you buy to virtualize it. You want to have those techniques available.
I
think it might be a better approach to get rid of architectures, because Intel is the architecture which mostly has new hardware, and the other architectures, maybe we can get dropped some architectures for the edge point half kernel.
Actually, coming back to vServer, if we only say, well, this is a small gain in a minor kernel subversion inherited of vServer, I would say, yes, we keep vServer, of course. But if you say, well, basically, we can't do vServer, or we have to take today's kernel because there's no vServer development happening in the next year, what I don't expect. Basically. Then I would say, well, one year difference would perhaps make it worse. So it depends. We need to decide in the end. But I wouldn't say dropping vServer is a total no-go. It's one thing I would like to avoid, but other things might outweigh.
You don't want to have big regressions, basically, in functionality, and dropping vServer is not a regression.
It's not a regression, but we just have a drop of flavor. What I, of course, wouldn't do is say we do a vServer kernel which doesn't work. Then that would not be a regression. The same if you don't provide vServer kernels is, well, something I would like.
Regression in the feature set.
No, it's actually less than a plus than expected
over
the code.
Well, I would of course prefer to have vServer. I don't think there's any doubt that I like vServer. I'm not a vServer myself, so I definitely would profit from it.
So I have a question. Is there any thought given to the Congo architecture support?
That's the first I've heard of that idea. Dropping some architecture.
I'm not really all that familiar with the program, but it seems to me that there's a definite chance that certain architectures won't be supported as well in this code as well,
But to be honest, I've never really worried too much about other architectures being there. I mean, if the newer kernels don't work very well, then you still have the older one there. So the problem may just be if they don't build for another architecture, we might consider dropping it. Or is there another reason you're thinking?
I'm just thinking, is it even worth, it seems like most of the problems are in the middle hardware, and there's no new MIDS hardware coming out, so is it even worth bothering making an edge and a half release and everything for those kind of
problems? There are, I think, two reasons why we would like to have the same problems as everywhere. So one is, three reasons. One is, of course, just that we didn't say, we are doing things consistent over all architectures. The second is, if there are no issues, why should we drop it? Because it's probably even easier to just build it if it's built and it works as well.
Probably is. My question is just, is it worth bothering if there's, what's more important? If there's a problem, is the MIPS coming up and we just drop it, or we just make the extra effort to make it work, even though it might not be worth it.
What I would like to know from the kernel team is just, if you could just say that, you know, how bad, or how many issues do we have with other architectures? Do we have very many issues these days, or is it most just working? Because I really don't have an, for me, as my least natural point of view, it somehow is all stretched out in the kernel team and always one on, which is a true remark, but which doesn't yield much input for the question.
Basically, the build failures are already resolved by, because you have a kernel unstable anyway, so the build failures are going to be resolved soon enough, I think. Well, the runtime failures, the bugs, the regressions or something. Yeah, well, if someone has a mixed kernel that doesn't work but builds, he can always use the previous one, the 18 kernel, and be happy. I mean, the build time failures, yeah, we fix them anyway, so.
Yeah, and if the build failures, some of the recent ones were tool chain issues, I still think we'd be building with the Edge tool chain. So we wouldn't be dropping the SIM kernel in the Edge, we'd be building the Edge tool chain.
But it might be a good idea to push that kernel from proposed updates to SIP or something like CV, so that we have more people testing it. Even if you build it with Edge 2 chain.
Yeah, but it would probably be older than current SIP or something. So
you just need to stop the updating current SIP before we do it in time.
I think you need like an edge and a half proposed updates.
Well, yeah. There'll certainly be the, for the kernel, there'll be the build server .net, and that'll be built, building daily builds
of
against
course.
The edge tool chain.
But of course, you could even now just, because if you include it in edge, it needs to be proposed updates anyways.
Yeah.
You need to end up there. So you definitely can add proposed updates to your sources list these days without major risks, because nothing gets things that isn't reviewed by the stable release team. So that would be the test bed for it, of course. But I'm not too sure if it wouldn't help to also have it available in unstable for more test users. Because we know that unstable has a large test space as well. The people who don't mind so much booting their machines as most of the stable users.
And some more, I guess, simpler questions. What, well, maybe not simpler, but what do we name the source package? Because we want to have Linux 2.6 there. Do we do 2.6.18 or 2.6.23 or whatever?
I hope.
Okay. I think that would make more sense.
That seems the most logical solution for me.
And we'll need to deal with the meta packages. So right now there's Linux 2.6, Linux image 2.6-686 or something.
Mm-hmm.
So 2.6.23-686, something like that.
Well, the meta images are to provide for a default kernel, and if the intention is to keep the default as it is, you don't need to provide new meta packages.
It's not necessarily to keep the default, but to prevent automatic updates.
But if you're running the 2.6.23, just to name a number, you'll want to follow ABI changes to prevent security updates.
Well, yeah, I think that we already have Linux image 2.6.x meta package. Part of the main meta package, as well as the version things.
No, we'll say that again.
Like
I don't know what you
mean. Linux-image-2.6.21-686. That already exists.
Oh, I don't think so.
Yeah,
I just think
it does.
Does
it?
I got that
shit.
Mm-hmm.
Does it? Yeah. That so Linux, you think there's Linux-image-
No.
2.6.6?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, really?
That would make a lot of sense. Perhaps just need to invent new meter packages.
Yeah.
Some 2.6.23 meter packages.
So I guess what the X people, maybe it's a good thing about the X people talk about what you want to do or more, it's the kind of stuff you want to do. And then I'd like to come back afterwards and start talking about time frames. When do we think we want to do this? So people that are interested in X server or X driver updates,
so
if you are.
The new X server 1.3, it breaks in around, so we really can't talk about it. It breaks it completely entirely. Very nicely done, actually. So you can't backport that. The only driver updates and tools that we maintain, that the X-Ray Force maintains, are the Intel driver 2.0 and the new NV driver, both of which provide new hardware support. The Intel driver can build on Server 1.2, is that correct? So that can be backported. And then NV, I believe, should be backported fairly regularly. We can probably add a few modifications to the code to make it work. It's got regular one too, so
what? That means we need to update the server in H2.
Do we?
H has 1.1.
Is this not 1.2?
No, it's 1.2 was released later.
Okay, that's a problem. We could probably do it in the version.
So, how large are, if you say backport to Edge, how large are the changes? Do you think we should do a new package, or do you think we should rather just fix something in the current package?
NV we could probably just update. It's not a huge change yet. Intel we might want to do a new package, because it got renamed anyway, so it's almost like begging to be in the package, and that way people don't get screwed.
Basically, I don't see a necessary correlation between the changes between the current and X from my point of view. So if we have the extra release either early or later available, I don't see a reason to not just do them when we have them. Except of course for the test. But I don't think that we need to update the kernel and the X at the same moment of time.
No.
So we can just do it whenever it's available.
As a normal player, right? So maybe we should backport 1.2. I mean that's mainly bug fix for us. X server 1.2.
Well, if we add a new kernel, if we add a new extra, which is just a new package, I don't see really. But of course, we need proper testing before.
We need to synchronize the kernel packages and the X packages because there are kernel changes required for the new.
Ah, okay. So that is okay. So we need to have the kernel change at least before the X changes.
What's the other?
That's just a standard dependency.
No, unfortunately, in order to talk to new Intel hardware, I need a new kernel driver to map memory in an appropriate way to be able to adjust the hardware.
Wasn't that the change that we said we can even pipe back to 2.6.18?
Yes.
I think that was supposed to be in Edge R1.
So it's a backward
the
DRM.
The change for the DRM changes.
I hope that we get L1 out before we are ready with that.
So we need the DRM.
But that would be for L2 or whatever.
And G33
as well.
So we need new Mesa, wouldn't we? The stack only goes so high, that's about as deep as it is. At the maximum, you're going to need, at absolute maximum, you need a couple protocol headers, which are trivial. DRM, Mesa, X server, drivers. That's absolutely the maximum that you need. And I just don't need all that. It sounds bigger than it is. This is not small.
So those would all be getting new package names because they fail to run on kernels?
No, the Mesa changes, the kernel changes, and the libDRM changes are all just new hardware support, PCI additions, effectively.
And they don't depend on newer kernel?
No, they do not.
Okay, that's something which just is not fair anyways. You should just do that as soon as possible, I think.
The bits that actually do depend on new kernel need to get a new package name, I guess, for preventing people upgrades.
They need the new kernel package, they don't need a new kernel. We haven't done anything that requires a new kernel yet. But they need the driver update, kernel driver update.
So that you mean we can do the changes after we push them out at some normal point release, that we have some normal point release.
But doesn't that mean that you would need to update the current 2.6.18 kernel anyway? Because if you push out the new X packages without updating the current 2.6.18 kernel, you would not be able to use X anymore with that current kernel.
You mean going to updates? You mean that we in Debian are going to force our users to update the kernel? Which part do you mean? If we are going to update the kernel now for L1? Anyways,
yes.
And basically, I, or my basic assumption is that we will still go on and update in 2.6.18 with regarding to things like device IDs.
Yeah, I agree.
Independent of the export from half kernel or not.
But it means that you cannot depend on the Edge 0.5 kernel for these exchanges.
Now,
if you want to do them, you also have to update the 2.6.18 kernel, because you cannot force people to switch to a 2.6.23 kernel just because you want to update X.
Backwards compatible changes? Can they work? The new X can work with the old kernel for the old hardware?
No, it needs an update.
There will be some limited some functional limitations.
As far as I understood it, the updates that we will do to the 2.6.18 kernel are enough to run as packages.
I don't think so. The changes that are necessary for the new hardware support are new PCI IDs and small amounts of code that are dependent only on those PCI IDs.
Okay.
So there'll be a switch statement with 15 different PCI IDs, and the new PCI ID will have different code. So those changes are in line with new hardware support.
So there would be no regressions for any current users.
Right. I think that's the goal. So the kernel drivers do not introduce regressions for existing drivers.
Yes, I think that's something we can easily do in 2.6.18. Anyways, if you do in 2.6.18, I don't see a reason to make any special things about any X driver for this reason. Might for other reasons, but this is okay.
If new X software introduces no regression at all for current users, then I don't see a problem.
The new kernel modules. Now, the other piece, the other two pieces that we need are changes to the 2D X driver, and we have two routes that we can do that, because the changes for the new hardware are on top of the Explorer 2.0 driver at this point. Now, Ubuntu, Red Hat, and Novell have all taken those changes and ported them to their old X Server 1.1 based drivers. We can steal those drivers and ship new packages on top of Edge if we want, but it's a bunch of maintenance, because all of a sudden now we have a fork. Right? We have the old packages and we have the new packages, and we have to maintain essentially two totally parallel trees of packages. I don't know if we have bandwidth in the X-Strike course competitive at this point. The other piece that we've need updated in a similar fashion is the Mesa GL library. Again, the hardware support for new Intel chips is on top of, you know, a year and a half, 2 years of development of Mesa. And so backporting those, it has been done by other distributions. Do we want to take their patches, review them, and incorporate them into our stable series as well?
For what it's worth, we haven't gotten like major breakages with Mesa at all. I don't know if we had any breakages with Mesa or things. So it's pretty solid. I go back and review the bug reports. Right. I think it's been pretty good.
I think the server's a lot, because the server has been more sensitive than Mesa.
Yeah.
Breaks stuff accidentally. We have a bunch of regressions in the current Mesa that are breaking the test suite.
So the other option, the backporting, is to update the server.
Right. The other option to backporting is to shipping desktop bits.
Yeah.
But to some extent, that doesn't seem appropriate to me. It seems appropriate for us to get basic hardware functionality to make sure that people can get their systems up and running, and then decide if they want new feature support, including fancy hardware support, they need to move to a new distribution.
Yes.
I think that's a reasonable position for Debian to be in. Now, obviously, Snowball and Red Hat are in a different space with their guaranteed 5 years of support. And those developers are in a world of hurt right now. And while they have staff that are, in fact, Intel has paid staff to help them with that, I don't think we're in a position to be able to offer that kind of support. If you want new hardware, zippy features, we have this.
Use lucky.
Right.
Sometimes I think it makes sense to add a bit of more support to stay, but of course, we can't say we will always have to validate this stuff. So I think that the X plus 1/2 thing is, I think, just a good middle position between everything and nothing.
I think my goal for the ongoing stable support is to make sure the hardware that I ship today we can install.
That's a good thing.
I think that's a basic level of functionality, and that people can use the system in some limited capacity and decide whether they want to go
to a more recent distribution without having to...
Yeah, if I were to describe in one sentence like what I think Etch-n-a-Half is about, I would say it's to show that Debian can add hardware support. So I don't want, think the first time around, this is just my opinion, I think the first time around we want to add hardware support, definitely not risk breaking anything, and just to show that we can do it right.
I think that needs to be tempered by the cost of what the hardware support is going to do. For something like the hardware support for adding class-based AHCI drivers,
right.
Absolutely, I think it's an appropriate driver support to add. But when you talk about adding Intel 965 graphics driver support, we could do it, but it would need a new X server and a new Mesa.
What if we just did skip the Mesa and just did two? I mean, it's crap, but it's an alternate packaging. We say, well, at least you get this, if you really want something newer.
I think that might be appropriate, where we offer limited functionality at the point where people can use the interface they're familiar and friendly with and comfortable with to get to installing
the distro. Being able to get to a useful 2D desktop from Etch and whatever installing media, so that you can then make the decision to move to testing, seems like a reasonable place to try and go.
Yeah.
I know that one of the challenges we as a distribution have been facing recently is the fact that even as recently as now after the release of Etch, there's a whole new ration of hardware that you just can't install Etch on. So
every machine I own.
So Zobel asks on IRC if the security team, what does the security team think about these updates? As for the kernel, I'm happy with maintaining the second one, assuming we can make it as close to dropless charge support as possible. I won't be happy about maintaining four kernel source trees at the same time, but when we go down to two or just a short overlap, I'd be happy. What do you think about X?
Yeah. Well, the parts we're talking about, X we're talking here about now, are typically not the ones which are prone to security problems. Recently, it's mostly been all the formatting stuff, which wouldn't be affected with the stuff directly. And so I don't think X is the major problem here. And with the kernel, we should probably go for something less than the 12 months of post-kernel support we provide for the kernel problem. So this should only be a stepstone towards Lenny or the eventual next release. So I think it would be quite sane to limit security support for 3 months after the release of the next level release.
And honestly, it'll be easier to maintain the Etch-n-a-Half kernel than the Etch kernel. So
I'm not sure I agree with it, to be honest.
Security-wise?
Security-wise. I know there's a lot of institutions that have not yet switched to Etch, do not plan to switch to Etch for the foreseeable future, but are going to keep on running Sarge. And limiting security support for a kernel like that is going to have a major effect on the usability of Debian for large institutions.
Well, then they need to upgrade to Etch, but not to Etch-n-a-Half, because you simply don't have the resources to maintain security.
Yeah, but if you ask me to choose, I would say, okay, let's not include a new kernel in Etch, but let's do continued security support for Sarge.
Wasn't the proposal to have a shorter security port cycle for the Etch-n-a-Half kernel?
Yeah.
Okay.
And leave the results
okay.
Keep the time frame for the Etch kernel.
That would be okay.
Yeah, and my comment was that, once we get past, right now doing starter support is ridiculously difficult because I have to manually build every architecture.
Yes, I know.
Once it gets to, we have Linux 2.6 type packages, just two of them. And the Etch-n-a-Half kernel will be easier to port to because it's newer. I think it won't be too much to keep going with it as long, but I think 2.6.18 is a priority.
Yes. Okay. No, I misunderstood. Sorry.
Back to the X issue. It's probably too early, but what is the situation with the new API driver?
The Amigo?
Julian
uploaded it to experimental.
Yeah, I mean about
it's sitting in there.
You mentioned that we're going to add the Intel hardware and then
it's not ready. Avivo's not ready for.
But probably by the time that Etch-n-a-Half, no.
I don't think so. I don't really know. I don't have that hardware on it, but it's It's really early days of that driver. It's just announced like a week ago. So it's really early days. I don't know that it's really ready to ship to people as a statement point release. It's really not ready.
Do you know about the Nouveau drivers?
No. This is like, yeah, I really, we need proper maintainers to these things. No one in the X-Strikeforce has an Evo, a chip supported by an Evo. None of the X-Strikeforce members has an NVIDIA chip, so we haven't really put in the work. I put out a call for Nouveau maintainers. Two people responded, including Noah Meyerhans. But Noah has not really followed up on that, neither has this other guy.
Do you want hardware?
Sure, if you have PCI Express hardware for these things.
Yeah, send the mail to the XOR board, and if you have staff to do the maintenance for this, I can buy you.
Okay. I'll test it then, and I'll let you know.
If it's a hardware problem, I can fix it. I can't fix staffing problems.
Right, I'd be happy to work on it.
Cool.
Yeah, so that's been an issue. We haven't had the hardware.
That's easy. Those are just PCI Express ports.
Right. Okay, so that's your answer.
Open up the closet, pull boards out.
Is there a list of drivers that was present in the edge kernel that is no longer present in the current SIP kernel? I've had problems trying to upgrade because the module was gone.
That was my situation.
And like the old firmware I got doesn't work anymore, that kind of problem.
Did you look for the bug? Did you look for the bug?
Well, I didn't. It was a handmade upgrade of like a backported kernel, so no, I didn't.
There is an issue I know. The VCM 43 FX module, which is for Broadcom Wireless, found in PowerBooks. They changed. Basically, they're using a newer firmware now by Broadcom. So the new driver depends on the newer firmware. So you have to add the new firmware. That's an issue. I know.
So no, better. I don't have that list.
Okay. We should probably make that list. We got a complaint from the DBNADU user that his old DATEC RAID controller doesn't work anymore, and when we have been digging into it, it seems like his old kernel module is no longer present in the kernel, and we have no idea what the new name is, and it's not just detected, so maybe it's just gone.
We can just make a diff.
Yeah.
Well, sure, if I had the machine, yeah.
Well, okay, yeah, you're talking about actual file differences in modules.
Well, sure, yeah.
Sure, that needs to exist, but let me tie this back to this conversation a little more. What if 2620s, whatever, doesn't have a certain driver that 2618 had?
Yeah.
Do we consider that a regression for edge and a half?
If it's required to support some hardware.
But 2618 is still there. So the hard
The upstream kernel will just drop the driver because they said you don't want to do it anymore. Like, you're not going to drop the kernel.
So basically, we're talking about a new system like an Intel new one that uses a piece of hardware that isn't supporting the new kernel. I don't think that's really
actually, I think that's the same discussion as we had before with the V servers. We wouldn't like it. If we could avoid it, we should avoid it, but not at all costs. So it's the important things. That we gain by saying when we go to a newer kernel version, but it also depends on which piece of hardware. If you just got the generic support for PCI based graphic cards, I would say yes, it's a regression.
And hard drives.
Or whatever. Yes, but there are things I would say definitely a no, but if there's some piece of hardware that expects that only two people in there will ever use, it might be enough to document it as a release notes.
Well, so look, my personal perception is that the transition from Sarge stable to Etch stable was difficult for some people because of things that we decided to change in what we're building and delivering, like not including the Keyspan serial drivers because of the promotion, things like this. The real question is, are there any sort of meaningful reductions in the list of delivered drivers from the 18 to whatever the current list that's been proposed for Etch and a half? I don't know the answer. If some truly obscure something got dropped by kernel.org upstream between those two versions, I wouldn't sweat that too much. But if there's something where we've made any decisions or fixed the one more oops, we forgot to fix that, and took something else away for Etch and a half that was there for Etch, that would be a much bigger question to me.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. because the situation, for example, with the Keyspan serial stuff, that's, you know, the motivation for taking that action is quite clear, and everyone who reads into the rationale understands what the point is, but it was a situation where, you know, one day hardware that many people have and were using the systems didn't work after they did an update, and that's the kind of regression that I think you have to be careful about sort of doing intentionally in a stable point.
Peter, I don't know if you were already here when we discussed it, but we are definitely not intending to change the defaults so that people get a new kernel without making a voluntary choice about it. And we are still supporting the old kernel.
Okay.
So I'm not as much concerned as it would be with this
level. Not as difficult, yeah. So now they maybe have a choice to make between do I want this new thing or do I want something. Okay.
And if the new one breaks, they can just go back.
Okay, that would sort of go back to your question, if you actually sort of need someone to make a list of what was there and was not there to make some educated decisions.
Is that as simple as a config diff or something?
Suggested.
Not always, because the config options change names.
Yeah.
I don't think we can
mind clear what the difference is.
It would be great if somebody who cared about this can get involved in the release notes.
Yes, it's cool idea.
Basically, if someone has a new system that doesn't work with the current kernel and has an adapted card that doesn't work with the new kernel doesn't support him, how can we support him? I mean, there is a kernel that supports him. How can we do that?
I don't think that anybody in the kernel team is invested in dropping drivers just to drop them. So all of these drivers would be to say, well, we have now to make a hard decision between either this bunch of hardware not supported or this bunch of hardware not supported, and then we have to just decide which is lesser bad. Of course, you prefer to just support all. So if you have this question, we don't say, well, we can either support this or that. We just say, well, we either don't support your system at all, or we just support it but have some minor stuff that will support it. I think it's easy to answer. But really, we have to have a discussion about that when we really go to the issues of, well, what issues are open currently, which hardware is in danger of us being blocked for the H+1/2 kernel, which are the things to be gained, and then to make a decision. It's really, I don't have enough, I don't see what will happen with the kernel in the next half year. To make any decisions now.
Well, that's documented in that inside the kernel source tree and the scheduled future removal text file. And it only lists really, really obscure junk. They're extremely cautious about dropping existing drivers. They even maintain the whole completely obsolete open sound system back from the early 90s just because some ultra obscure ego hardware nobody knows anymore is not supported by ALSA, so I don't think that's actually an issue.
Well, the main thing is when there are rewrites of drivers like you had with Megarate, where the new drivers do not support the really ancient hardware that was supported by the old driver anymore, because basically, the guy who did the read-write did not have access to that ancient hardware anymore, and also had something like, I don't care enough to support 20-year-old RAID support, RAID devices. Does the same with PCMCIA. There was a major rewrite of PCMCIA with new user space stuff.
Those are big transitions.
Those are big transitions, and all stuff does get lost in those transitions. But that's upstream's choice. And if people want those requests fixed, basically if they have the hardware, they have to get involved.
But of course, it's the other patch. It's okay, we can include the patch, and then the patch up to hard and upstream as we do so.
Yeah. One thing, I'm not sure if it has been discussed already, but we have the BATA. What drivers? I would suggest that should not be enabled for 0.5 release.
Yeah, I don't think we want to break upgrades between edge and edge.
Yes, especially with the HDA, SDA changes and so on, which we're not prepared for at the moment.
But speaking of that, it might be a little off topic for this, but might be a better question for Leia. Do you think that the persistent naming stuff will help solve that problem?
Colin told me earlier this week that he has good things for that. We need to get to work together with you guys, the current team, to get transition in upgrades supported. And that may even involve getting it into an export release at some point to have things on people's system as much as possible. But it will be a major Edge Lenny upgrade headache.
Dan?
So we've got 10 minutes left. Should we, is it too early to start talking about time frames for this? All I know right now is 2.6.21 now, but beyond that, we haven't seen others.
If it's a hack, that would be my construct.
Oh, that's true.
What did you say?
If it's supposed to be edge and a half, then it's my construct. That sounds quite reasonable, actually.
I think we need to get very quickly, because there is one out there, it doesn't mean.
You need to start quite quickly if you want it in.
Well, the other sort of thing I have been mentioning is just doing it continuously, really.
There are a few things that we could include into Edge R2, which we don't need to wait for Edge plus and half.
Yeah.
So I think we should do that as soon as possible. Just that on my mail that L1 is now mostly closed. So it's just R2, which would be okay. And then we could get at least the new Intel hardware working with Edge. And I hope that we are able to get out Edge R2 in 2 to 3 months. Something like that would be cool. And if we have that, I think the most visible kernel problems are solved then. And so it takes a new kernel, which should be then in another, whatever, 5 months from that date. That means something like 8 months from now.
Yeah, I think my default would be to want to take 2.6.23 as soon as it's in unstable. And start making a backport branch and start uploading probably 2.6.23.
Yeah. Can those releases have a tendency to break things at a certain release? Like the 2.6.21 was breaking many stuff because of the IB dynamic fix thing. And you don't know what's going to be on 23 after you know. 22 will be a pretty stable release, for example. We know that for sure. But 23, we don't know that yet.
Yeah, and it might be that we see that other distributions start on 22 and we do that instead.
But actually, I've learned not that so much if Upstream tells us that this kind of release is going to be stable.
Yeah.
So we have our own form decision, anyways. Or basically, you will have.
But when they say the next one is going to be very unstable, you can believe them.
But that's, I'm not sure that's true for any kind of.
And you said that for 21, yes.
But we're not going to take 21, of course.
When do you expect 23 upstream?
They've been pretty regular. I believe it's every 2 months. Are they doing upstream releases?
And a half.
2 to 3. So 22.
Yeah.
Late summer, early fall, maybe is what I would guess. People on the kernel, kernel RC channel. Right?
Well, the summit coming in September, it's unlikely to either be more likely to be just before the ship release. There's a historical tendency to want to drop a new release and just before summer, but I don't know if that'll happen.
Okay, that might be good.
September.
Okay, so I think it's the right time to start working on it.
In September, you're getting it down stable and then eventually getting it to.
It's happening at the same time as LinuxConf for Europe and Cambridge this year. It's not OLS, which is next year.
Yeah. Have you put the feed in the box now? And all of this ATA changes, that means the names of the device at least are happening after the Edge 1.5 kernel. So it happens on the Edge or Edge 1.5 upgrade to serve Lenny for the users. We will see the changes anyways, so we don't have to care about that now.
Are we going to try to get the same kernel for a decent time into unstable first?
Yes, I'd like to use unstable to get all the architectures building and all that stuff first.
Yeah. and enable maybe delay an possible next version in a stable to get an extended stabilization period for this kernel that we target for edge and a half?
Yeah, either way, and I would obviously be watching the unstable and merging stuff. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I would prefer, what seems logical to me, if you just handle it like you would have handled the edge kernel or would handle the Lenny kernel. Just put an unstable, make it stable, so everything is okay with it.
Get it into testing?
Yes. So they have all. So
yeah, but you really have to work with the unstable kernel team on this to make sure things happen as we want them. Yeah. Because basically the current kernel team ignores testing completely, which sucks.
That's not true. Warren is also part of the kernel team.
The people who manage the releases totally ignore testing.
I'm not sure they ever manage the releases in the kernel. But yes, I know what you mean. But we are safe. I can't now say anything about certain people.
Oh, I don't care.
Yeah, because you don't know the developer. I am.
Are there any efforts going on to make sure that the SID unstable kernels actually are buildable in Edge? At the moment they are not because they depend on numeric cordials, among other things.
Yeah, I mean there's certainly, we're not going to take the Edge kernel and just recompile it in Edge. There'll be a branch of sorts to deal with that stuff. And I think Waldy's been wanting, they have already done this drop kernel package dependency, so maybe that we go back with the old build system that we used in Edge and just drop 21 on top of it, or 23 or whatever. So that's all to be determined. We'll figure out how to make it buildable and install. Right. That'll be the step.
I would suggest to make them backportable, like with only a rebuild. Rewrite the build system to actually work in Edge.
If you can talk about SID kernels, you can talk to Wally about that.
Yeah.
But problem is we'll make the Edge one work.
A lot of things have been blocked for a long while because of the libc transition. So testing hasn't been as up to date as it would normally be. That's quite normal, I think, just after a stable release when there's major changes happening all over the distribution. I don't think the fact that the unstable kernel has been unbuildable for a while is a major issue in testing.
Right.
For that reason.
As far as I can see from that packet, it was different semantics of read link that enforced a new coroutils dependency. And I'm pretty sure it's possible to write a transcript that works in both Edge and unstable for read link.
Yeah, we're out of time now. So final questions or anything? I think the room still goes wrapped an hour, but we should have gone.
Well, I think the only question that still is open, but perhaps we just leave it open as for now, would be how do we use the installer? But yeah, you can just leave it open as for now.
I have one small question.
Sure.
Where is the discussion for Edge and a Half going to take place on this? Is it Debian release?
Actually, well, we prefer to not have too many discussions on Debian release, so we could take Debian Devel, but if it's necessary to get into a Zoom with not so many people, we can still switch to release or botchap or whatever you like.
Okay.
Because we try to avoid too many discussions have on Debian release, because yeah, it's hard to tell people when to stop discussing on a list that's a more an old account.
But I agree that just having it on kernel is probably not the right place.
Yes,
because it has a broader impact.
Yeah, how about the value?
Yes, that sounds right.
Well, I guess that's it.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.